You know that in the 70s, the major European and, I mean, Western states, including America and Canada, they begin to move the big number of industries to the third world, to the third world states, like Thailand, Vietnam, Pakistan, India, just like to even to some African countries, Indonesia. Why it happens?
People think because the wages increased,
okay,
and so
no.
they have to.
Many people mistakenly believe that this move of the industries in the 70s, that was in the 80s also, they continue to move, and by the 90s, I believe that the major part of the industries in the West was just moved to the third world. So many people believed that it was done because the allegedly labor in those states is cheaper, and so that will help them to
make more profit.
In reality, it is not true. In reality, those people who run the industries, they are not politically correct. The politically correct politicians will not talk about this because that's what I'm talking is politically incorrect. Even the mathematics, you see, became politically incorrect science. Even the arithmetics of the second grade in the school. So, but those people who run business, they cannot afford to be politically correct because they will have no workers in their factory, and they see that in 20 years or in 15 years they will have no enough workers to run their plants, to run their factories, and they had to do something about it. So soon after the sexual revolution in the West, the big guys who run the big industries, they begin to realize that soon, in the course of maybe next 20 years, they will simply have not enough workers to work.
Would have to pay so much because there was so much competition for the remaining workers.
Yes, of course.
So they will think that they would have to pay like $10,000 to a worker.
Yes. Before it was that the situation, then the a man look for the job. But then it become the other way around, that the job is look for the man. And when the situation is like this, the
wages would just
They
would demand just
because they are valuable, though they will demand as much as they can. They can blackmail the employers. So that's why they begin to move all those industries from the West to the third world states. And by the end of the 80s, almost there were no more industries remain in the West, except the key branches of the industry, like a shipbuilding, nuclear weapons production, weapons production. I mean, just like nuclear reactors
highly
production.
Technical.
Not even highly technical. I would call it key, like, you know, that to produce, let's say, personal computer is more highly, it is high technology, or even the small mobile phone, than to produce a ship, because ship is quite primitive. So it's not the matter, that is not the matter of the technology. That is the matter of the domination. Because if the third world states produce iPhones, or let's say the t-shirts or the shirts, that's not a big deal. The West could still control it. But if they begin to produce their own medicine, their own weapons, their own genetically modified agricultural products, planes, that one is already unacceptable. Because will make them powerful and independent. So that there are certain key industries, such as airplane building, ship building, weapons production, medicine, and those things that related to genetical modification of the agricultural product, that one they still keep. But even to maintain this, they don't have enough work power now. They don't even have enough now workers to work as the servants in the restaurants. It's just they don't have enough people now, because Europe and the West in general are so badly depopulated. I told you the mathematical example. In just in 60 years, out of 160 million, you can easily make 40 million with still alive pensioners. So now they don't know what to do. They don't have enough workers to run the few remaining industries in the West. And of course they had to invite migrants from poorer countries just to replace the population that they lost. And that's by the way why Europe suffers from all those hated migrants. It's just another side of the same coin.
You think that these people like Angela Merkel from Germany,
mm-hmm.
they act in the best interest of the nation, of the state, when they bring these migrants?
No, you
migrants.
See, I believe that in the best interest of the state, sorry, I'm very politically incorrect, was Adolf Hitler.
Yeah.
Because what he attempted to do,
yeah.
he attempted to exterminate the homosexuals and to reintroduce the family values.
Yeah.
So he just forced the women to be women and to be mothers.
Yeah.
And he forced the men to be a man.
Yeah.
And that, yes, is in the
that
best interest
of
the state.
That would have been sustainable.
Yes, of course.
Yeah.
Because in this way, he just returned. I not approve of fascism.
Yeah,
not
yeah.
I approve of Nazism.
Yeah.
But that is the right way to do.
Yeah.
So, but what Frau Merkel does,
mm-hmm.
she didn't treat the cause of the problem.
Mm-hmm.
It's just like people have a syphilis, and
mm-hmm.
then they just try to treat the how they call that, the ulcer of it,
yeah.
instead of the treating trying to kill the bacteria
yeah.
that causes it.
Yeah.
So what she does, she just try like to make like some
to mask the symptoms
so that she needs let's say that population of Germany to be let's say 60 million
mm-hmm.
but in reality it's like let's say 18 million. So what she can do?
Mm-hmm.
So she just bring in the immigrants and
mm-hmm.
trying to pass them for the German and to trying to pass the high birth rate that is provided by the migrants
mm-hmm.
as a kind of acceptable birth rate
mm-hmm.
for the Germany
average.
For the average, yes.
Mm-hmm.
But this is of course not a solution.
Mm. Because not many people actually think that Merkel is evil and just trying to destroy the German culture and the German people,
mm-hmm.
like as a by just mixing in so many migrants.
No, but simply
yeah.
she has no choice because
yeah.
because the average man in the street,
yeah.
he doesn't see the problem.
Yeah.
He doesn't understand that he himself failed to make four children
yeah.
and his neighbor as well.
Mm.
All they see that they see that those black faces in the street,
mm.
all those offensive people who how to say abuse the hospitality of the
mm.
of the Germany.
Mm-hmm.
That's they see, but they don't understand why it happened.
Yeah. And they don't take responsibility, and they're not able to admit that it's their own fault by not having.
You see, the first of all, they are not being explained this
mm.
because this is politically incorrect.
Mm.
What I'm talking now is politically incorrect thing.
Mm.
They don't want to talk about this
mm.
even. And when it comes to their ability to analyze on their own, that is
mm.
very simple to analyze. All you need to do is just to be able to make very simple mathematical
mm.
calculations and to understand that if men and a woman do not make children,
mm.
then the nation will die out very soon.
Yeah.
This is very simple. And then they just to draw the conclusion that because they do not want to make children, it
mm.
doesn't matter what pretext they found to justify it.
Mm.
That means they are the ones who is responsible. It's not
mm.
Merkel.
Mm.
Okay, probably I don't know how many personally children she has, but it doesn't matter.
Mm.
She might have maybe even four children or have none, but
mm.
Her personal example is nothing. It's
mm.
just the duty of every German man and every other
mm.
man to have children,
mm.
and as well as the woman.
Mm.
So, but as long as that she is the leader of the state,
mm.
She has to do something about it,
yeah.
and she does the best she could do.
Yeah.
Of course, probably she could maybe do more like Adolf Hitler,
mm.
just order to shoot all the homosexuals.
Mm.
And to deprive
yes.
the females of their rights and make the law that unless the female doesn't make four children, doesn't give birth to four
mm.
children, she will be the enemy of the state. Yeah, but she cannot go that far.
Like they could argue that instead of giving the money to the migrants, they could just increase the benefits for having children. because the migrants apparently also cost a lot of money
of
to
course
maintain.
They cost
so
a lot
they,
of money.
So they, you think even if they would increase the benefits for children for getting,
but you have to understand one thing that okay, first of all, they have hope. I mean, those who run Germany and similar countries, they have hope that the, when those immigrants stay in Germany long enough, or at least their children taught in German school, maybe they will be kind of smoothly integrated into the German society and become more or less like a German people. And I don't think it will really work because they are too different, but maybe they believe that it will work, at least it will work to a certain extent. And at least what they believe is better to have bad population than to have not population at all. That's because it's simple. Because the problem is that the white nations, I mean all like German, French, Italian, Swedish, Norwegian, Russian, Czech, they are dying out. The Bulgarian, for example, Bulgaria is no longer a Bulgarian country. They have gypsies more than Bulgarians. And because the Bulgarians, they stopped making children in the 70s.
So you think even if they would increase the benefits and the incentives for having children, it would still not be enough?
It will not work because you have to understand that the to make to have children and to maintain children is hard. Is a big job. It's more is a harder than just to have a work. So before people used to have children out of moral obligation, so they know that this is just the obligation of a Christian, or it is obligation of a Muslim, or it's just obligation of a Homo sapiens, or an obligation of a human. And as long as they lost the feeling that it is obligation, it doesn't matter. You can offer them the money, and instead of one children, some family will have two. And instead of the two children, some family will have three, just because of you give them money for that. But that is not a solution. Because the family must have four children, and all families must have at least four children. And that one you will not achieve with giving them the money. You have to change the moral. And how you can change it? Because they are not going to change the moral.
And you also, like many people, also suggest that, for example, the pension system and this was introduced to decrease the importance of the family and to therefore make the state more important for the people. So actually to decrease freedom in a way, because people were then more dependent on government, on the state benefits.
I don't think so.
You don't think that it was a deliberate way?
No. You see, first of all, you know that I'm very fair man.
Yeah.
I do not accuse even the bad guys of the things that they didn't do in reality. That's why, for example, I do not accuse American government of making 9/11 because they didn't make it. I accuse them of sending unprotected people to work on Ground Zero and die from radiation sickness. Yeah, that is their crime. But they are not the one who really made the 9/11. They are just victims of it. So the same thing, I don't want to accuse the those people who run the state in the things that you imply. In my opinion, it is not so. So, like, you know that before the end of the 19th century, the society was clearly divided into the nobility, like aristocrats, and the commoners. So all those responsible positions in the state system, in state apparatus, in the military. I mean, anyone who has the rank in the military above one star lieutenant was an aristocrat, or at least a former commoner who was brought up to be equal to aristocrats. Because of his university
education.
So, before the end of the 19th century, the commoners, and especially uneducated commoners with low moral values, they have no say in the society. They were just nobody and nothing, nobody listened to them. So all the government positions even the lowest ones were occupied by aristocracy or by highly educated intelligence. Not intellectuals, intelligence in the sense of intelligentsia. I mean, those commoners who were made formally equal to aristocrats on account of their high education. So that's why these people maintain more or less good morals.
Mm-hmm.
They maintain the classical culture. They didn't allow the mass culture. You know why the classical culture were persistent before the First World War? Because the aristocrats simply didn't accept the mass culture. And they were the ones who run the society.
And there were no mass media also?
No, mass media was available from the 17th century. The newspapers are very old, the magazines are very old.
Yeah, true.
So it doesn't matter. It was just because the society was not run by the slaves. It was run by the humans.
Mm-hmm.
And the humans, of course, they wanted to maintain a good morals.
Mm-hmm.
So they wanted to maintain family values.
Mm-hmm.
They want to maintain the classic culture.
Mm-hmm.
The classic arts and so on, the classic music.
Mm.
So there was no all those mass culture and all those I can't even call it art. It's just like, you know, the children in the probably in the kindergarten, they can make better picture than the most of the modern painters.
Mm-hmm.
Nobody.
Yeah.
You know, I'm very cynical.
Yeah.
So let's say that what happened at the beginning of the 19th century. At the beginning of the 19th century, more and more commoners with low morals begin to acquire education. First, they get the full school education, I mean the secondary school, then the high school, then a lot of them enter the university. And by the end of the 19th century and the beginning of the 20th century, there was a big new class. Educated slaves. Before, that class simply didn't exist. Educated were only humans.
Mm-hmm.
So at the beginning of the 20th century, a new class came into existence that called educated slaves.
Mm-hmm.
So these educated slaves, they moved from the villages to the cities, and the population of cities greatly increased on account of them. And of course, these people, because they became formally educated,
mm-hmm.
they begin to demand their share in politics.
Mm-hmm.
And of course, they in order to be elected, they had to pass some populist ideas.
Promise some.
Yes, of course.
Things.
So all, and that is where all those socialist ideas came from. Because the socialist ideas in the long prospect, they are very destructive.
Mm-hmm.
Most of them, at least. So those people with the traditional views, like aristocracy, they understood this very well, because they were able not only to see tomorrow, but also after tomorrow.
Mm-hmm.
But all those, educated slaves with no morals at all, when they begin to promote their socialist ideas, yes, they got the public vote, and then they had to do something. So they begin to introduce various social benefits, and the pension system was one of them.
Mm.
But it doesn't mean they had bad intention. No, they didn't want to yet to destroy the society.
Mm.
They just want. They believe that it's just mathematically justified and socially justified, as that was beginning in our conversation. I already explained it to you. And they didn't mean to destroy the state or to depopulate the state in that sense. That was just a byproduct.
Yeah.
They were not able to see the consequences of it. Yeah. So then what happened next? After the First World War, as you remember, there was a big increase in the quality of the healthcare system. Antibiotics were widely introduced.
Yeah.
The most dangerous disease was defeated.
Yeah.
Like those that you know that still in the 20th century more than 500 million people was killed by smallpox alone in the 20th century. So, but it was even more in the 19th century. And also they managed to defeat cholera and plague and many other diseases that were killing people on a big scale. And then they managed to greatly decrease the
death rate
among the young children. And also, in the same time, the lifespan of the older people was extended. So the Freemasons, who actually at that moment replaced the aristocracy as the main power running the state, they I think they were right, because in the 20s and in the 30s they begin to be they begin to fear that with the previous birth rate
mm-hmm.
and with the new achievement in medicine, the Earth will soon be overpopulated and there will be no enough resources
mm-hmm.
to maintain that ever increasing population. So they see it as a real danger. So they begin to introduce what they call so-called family planning. So in but that was in the 20s and in the 30s.
And also out of good intentions.
Yes, of course, it was out of good intentions. They didn't mean to completely destroy it. Maybe, yeah, maybe to a certain extent they want to decrease the influence of the family, because the family is something competitive with the state. That's why they want to make family less patriarchal and more slavish. But they still didn't want to destroy it completely. Also, in the same time, but I don't want to go deep in this, it is described in my book, the Freemasons at that moment believed that they can grow, and how to say, they can replace the natural pregnancy of a woman by some kind of industrial production of the
kids.
Of the kids, yes. So they believe that they can make kids without mothers. But
like described in the Brave New World.
Yes. So no, they really believe that in the 20s that because the science is so developed
advanced,
that the soon they will achieve the ability to make children outside of the female
womb
and without mothers at all. But didn't work. They were not able to achieve that, but at the moment they still believe in that. So anyway, and once they would achieve that, they will have a good control over the population. So they were wrong in this, but their intention to decrease the danger of overpopulation was, I believe, justified. But that was justified in the 20s and in the 30s. But after the Second World War, a new problem came, sexual revolution. So the result of the sexual revolution, females begin to believe that their body belongs to them, and whether to give birth or not to give birth, and how many children to have, is entirely up to them, up to their decision. So I would put it this way, that as a result of the sexual revolution, the females monopolized the ability to give birth, and they monopolize actually the future of the human civilization. And after they monopolize it, they decided not to give birth. And that is in this way the generation is doomed. So if I would say that in the 20s and the 30s, when it comes to the Freemasonic attempt to limit the birth rate out of good intentions, when they introduced the family planning, what happened in the 50s as a result of the sexual revolution, that is just the pure degradation of morality and with disastrous result, and that's all and that caused the demographic catastrophe, and actually put the so-called white civilization at the brink of the extinction. So as I say, the pension system and the increase of the pension age is just a very little problem in comparison with the fact that the society of the white people, I mean the white civilization, the bearers of it, they just no longer reproduce. And actually they are dying out.
So what do you think will happen if they will just die out and
will die out. So I would say that the so-called white civilization, what is perceived as European or Euro-American white Christian civilization that introduced the major inventions, the science and all technological achievements of the last three centuries, now is dying out, and I believe that this generation is the last more or less successful generation, because the next generation will be just like that will be the really last one, because in the next generation I mean the generation of the those people who are like kids now, when they become adult, the society will not be like that, and it's highly unlikely that it will exist whatsoever, because it might collapse
completely.
It might collapse completely and to be kind of like in the Mad Max movies, you know, with the desert. And the people running the rusty motorcycles and eating the remnants of the food, the last remnants of the food accumulated by the previous civilization, and running their motorcycles on the last benzene and the kerosene accumulated by the previous civilization. That is one of the options. And the second option, that the dying out morally unhealthy remnants of the white civilizations will be dominated and replaced in the most part by the people with healthier morals, like Muslims. But because those who will replace them are not so advanced scientifically, they have not the same education and a little bit different approach to the statehood and different relations between the individual and the family and the statehood, they most probably will not be able to sustain the same level of the civilization, the same level of technology, and the society will be maybe not collapse completely, but it will degrade to the level that the white people will find unacceptable. And there are good examples, like example of the South African Republic, or Tajikistan, and some other countries like this. So, but this one is a mild example, because when that happened in the middle of Europe or in the middle of America, it will be much more dangerous and much more awful. So that's what I believe will happen.
Yeah. So you think that the young people of today, there's no chance they will have any pension?
Pension? Of course not.
Yeah.
I'm not even talking about the pension. I'm talking that they will have not even the white society anymore. So forget about pension. When it comes to the pension, the people who are like now maybe in their 40s and 50s, that is the last people who will get the pension, maybe half of them at least. When they reach the age of like 75 or 77, because by the time they will approach the pension age, the government will have no choice than to increase it once again. Now they increase it, let's say, to 65, but the time they will reach that, they will increase it maybe to 75 or even to 77. And they already begin to talk about this. And this is, you cannot increase it anymore, this is really the last. And then maybe a few people who will reach that age, they will still have that pension. And when when it comes to the next generation, like who are now in their 20s or maybe in their 30s, they don't need to dream about it. They will not have pension even in the when they are 90 years old. It's just impossible, because the pension system proved itself to be wrong, and it can no longer maintain. And in the very best case, maybe, if the private pension system that exists in the form of a fund, maybe they can get some pension from there, but not sure.
So what would be your advice for the younger people below 50, 40? What should they do?
Nothing what they can do. I mean, you mean to have some.
What advice would you give to these people?
In the sense of getting some
getting
savings.
Prepared for their old age and like what?
The only thing they can do is try to save some money to buy some gold and just to keep the gold coins or maybe the gold in some other form. And so when they are old, because the gold is always gold, they can sell it little by little and exchange it for the then current money. Another thing is that they can have children, and not one or two, they can have like four or five, and to raise them in a proper manner, to give them good profession, good education, and not just like a manager or like, I don't know, tattoo maker or maybe so-called designer, because this kind of professions, they are useless in the healthy society. So they have to give them some profession that can exist in every society, like let's say a doctor, a medical doctor, or maybe dentist, or something that is always in demand. And then and these people can survive in any society, and they can provide some income, and they can share this income they can have some income and they can share this income with their aging parents. That is the only thing that I can advise.
Yeah, that is some good advice.
Yes,
yeah.
That's but it's logical, and that is the only thing.
And
they
it
can
involves do. Personal responsibility and this kind of.
Yes.
So with this advice, I think we will end this video now for the moment.
Yeah, unfortunately our time is limited and
yeah.
Every conversation must come to its end, but I hope it will be interesting for the people.
And
thank you for viewing.